Brain Hub.
Hello, welcome to another presentation here in Sibnayan Hub. This is another presentation aligned to a specific chapter in mathematics in the modern world called problem solving and reasoning. In this presentation, we're going to apply what we learned under the first video, which differentiates deductive from inductive reasoning, and also from our second video, which presents Polya's four-step problem solving. So we do this by examining some logic puzzles here. We have logic puzzles, and then we apply the different reasoning to solve them. Apply also Polya's fourth step of problem solving. What could be some benefits of solving logic puzzles like the ones that we will be presenting? First, it improves our critical thinking. It might also be a means for us to apply our knowledge in mathematics. And if we could improve ourselves in those areas, critical thinking and application of mathematics that we learn in our mathematics courses, then definitely we could also be a better problem solver. A problem solver not only to a mathematics problem, but a general problem that we encounter in life, from funny logic puzzles to becoming a critical thinker and a problem solver in our community. Let's go ahead and solve some of them. So the first problem here is actually about four neighbors: Sean, Maria, Sarah, and Brian, and each of them has a different occupation. One of them is an editor, the other one is a banker, the other is a chef, and the fourth person is a dentist. However, there is no telling which is which. From the following clues, there are four clues here that we have, the numbered sentences. Let's determine the occupation of each neighbor. So let's correctly assign the different occupations to the correct person based on some clues. So let's do that. This is just the same problem. This is the first clue. So reading on the first clue, we have Maria gets home from work after the banker but before the dentist. So we can apply again the two types of reasoning that we discussed earlier, and also Polya's four-step problem solving. So I guess the problem is really easy to understand. Our job here is to assign the different occupations to the correct person based on four clues. Now, what is our strategy? One possible strategy to answer this problem is to create a table. So we have here a table consisting, of course, of columns and rows. The columns represents the people, the four people involved in the problem, and then the rows represents the different occupations. And so based from the clue that we'll be utilizing, let us conclude something that is always true. It says here that Maria gets home from work after the banker, but before the dentist. That means that Maria is not the banker, nor the dentist. So what we can do in our table to mark what we conclude from the first clue, we can put an X mark here in this cell. This means that Maria is not the banker. Also, she is not the dentist. The second clue, we have Sarah, who is the last to get home from work, is not the editor. So the obvious conclusion that we can get here is that Sarah is not the editor. And therefore, we can put an X mark here. Sarah is not the editor. But what else? Is that the only conclusion that we can derive from the second statement? I don't think so. We have to connect the first two clues to get more conclusions from them. In the first statement, it said that Maria goes home before the banker. So the banker cannot be the last to go home. That also means that Sarah is not the banker because Sarah is the last to get home. The third clue says that the dentist and Sarah leave for work at the same time. So they cannot be the same person. We can put an X mark here. Sarah is not the dentist. So what now? If Sarah is not the editor, the banker, and the dentist, then she must be the chef. There's no other options left at this point for Sarah. If she is the chef, then Maria or Sean, we can start with Sean. Sean cannot be the chef. Maria cannot be the chef, and Brian cannot be the chef because it's explained in the problem that the occupations are well distributed to the people involved. What else? Maria is not the banker, the chef, nor the dentist. She must be the editor. That's the only option for her. That makes Sean not the editor nor Brian. What are other information that we can get here? I think we need the last clue. That is, the banker lives next door to Brian. So Brian is not the banker. He must be the dentist. And because of that, Sean cannot be the dentist because he is the banker. That's the last option for Sean. And so we now know that Sean is a banker, Maria is the editor, Sarah is the chef, and Brian is the dentist. How do we check that our answer is correct? We see that the occupations are well distributed to the people involved. Another logic puzzle that we can use to improve our critical thinking, to improve our problem-solving ability, are puzzles like KenKen puzzles or Sudoku or chess, or there are lots of puzzles. But let me give you a newer, less popular puzzle. It's called KenKen puzzle. KenKen puzzle is an arithmetic-based logic puzzle that was invented by a Japanese mathematics teacher. That's her name, Tetsuya Miyamoto, in 2004. This is really recent. The noun Ken has knowledge and awareness as synonyms. So Ken means knowledge or awareness. Hence, KenKen translates as knowledge squared or awareness squared. So what is a KenKen puzzle? It is a puzzle that is really similar to a Sudoku puzzle. I am pretty sure that you've seen Sudoku puzzle. You might have answered one. It comprises of squares divided into smaller squares. The dimension of a KenKen puzzle identifies the numbers or the set of numbers that we put inside the small squares. A 3x3 KenKen puzzle contains the numbers 1, 2, and 3. Similarly, a KenKen puzzle that is 4x4 in dimension contains the numbers 1, 2, 3, and 4. And what do we do with these numbers? Just like in Sudoku puzzles, these numbers here are distributed in rows and columns such that the numbers cannot be repeated. So that all numbers in each column or all numbers in each row must be unique. The numbers in each heavily outlined, so let me give you an example of it. This is an example of a KenKen puzzle. It looks like a Sudoku puzzle. This is a 4x4 KenKen puzzle. And our goal here is to distribute the numbers 1, 2, 3, 4, those four numbers, because this is a 4x4 KenKen puzzle. We need to make sure that there are no repeated numbers in each row or column. But wait, there's a catch here. The numbers in each heavily outlined sets of squares, they are called cages. If we observe, there are heavily outlined squares, and then we have the broken lines. These heavily outlined squares, as we mentioned a while back, it's called a cage. And what do we do in a cage? This is the first cage that we see. It's a cage comprised of three squares, 1, 2, 3. This is another cage, but it has only two squares, another three square cage. And then we have two square cage, another two square cage. This is a cage containing a single square, also here, and a cage composed of two squares. What is these cages all about? All numbers contained in a cage must be combined to produce the number that we see at the left part of each cage. We combine them using the specified operation. That means that apart from making sure that there are no numbers repeated in each row or column, we have also to make sure that if we combine the three numbers here by multiplication, the answer should be 6. In this cage, if we add the two numbers here, because there's only two contained in this cage, the sum is 7. For this cage, the three numbers must have a product of 8. What are the strategies that we can use to answer a KenKen puzzle? We can start with cages with a single square or single cages. Because for single cages, there are really no operation there because there's only one number, it's 2. So the number here is also the number in the square. So that's how we can start. We can start with smaller cages, a cage containing one square only. What are other strategies? Let me give you the strategies. If we are done identifying the single cages, we can also look for cages with 2 squares, because cages with lesser squares gives us lesser possible arrangements than when the cage is composed of more squares. What else? We can look for large or small target numbers, because a large or a small target numbers are the numbers or the results when we combine the numbers in the squares. These cages generally have few combinations of numbers that can be used to fill the cages. So let us have the same KenKen puzzle that I presented a while back. Let us answer it. So again, we can use the first strategy to start. So we can put here 2 and 1. We have 2 single cages. What's next? We can use the third strategy, look for a large or a small target numbers. Where could that be? I can start with 8. Why? Because I think there are fewer combinations that are possible for 3 numbers to have a product of 8. So from numbers 1, 2, 3, and 4, I think the only possible combinations there to have a product of 8 involves the numbers 1, 2, and 4. We cannot involve 3 because it can never give us a product of 8 if we combine it with the rest of the numbers there. So we have to distribute 1, 2, and 4. But we cannot put here 1 already because in this column we have a 1 here. So the only possibility is that if we put 1 here. So now we have to distribute 2 and 4. Well, we cannot put 2 in this square because we have a 2 in the same row. So the correct assignment should be this way. Again, we check that 1 times 4 times 2 is 8. What is next? We can complete the column. That's really easy. Remember that we are trying to distribute the 4 numbers from each column and row. So if we have 3 numbers here, there's only one possibility for this square. The number here should be 3 to complete the numbers 1, 2, 3, and 4. What else? We can put here 3. We are very sure of that, that the number here should be 3 to complete this row. We can continue by putting a 4 here. How do we know that? Because we have to satisfy the target number and the operation. That is, if we add the 2 numbers, it has to be 7. What is a number that gives 7 if added to 3? There's only one answer there, it's 4. Next, let us observe this cage. The 2 numbers that must be located here are numbers whose difference is 1. If 4 and 1 cannot be used already in this column, then we have only 2 possible answers for this cage. That is 3 and 2. So 3 minus 2 is 1. The difference is indeed 1. But how do we put them? We have to put 3 here. It cannot be 2 because we have a 2 in this particular row. This is 2. Let us answer this puzzle further. Let us also investigate this cage. It's containing 2 squares. The product should be 12. From the numbers 1, 2, 3, and 4, we cannot use 2 anymore. So we have 3 possible options, 1, 3, and 4. Well, 3 and 4 are the only 2 numbers that would give us a product of 12. So we have to distribute 3 and 4 in this cage. But specifically, how should we distribute? This should be 3. It cannot be here because there's a 3 in this row. This is 4. And therefore, the answer here is 4 to complete this row. And also, to complete this cage, the product of the 2 numbers here should be 4. So that's 1. We can now complete the other missing squares. That's 2 to complete this row. And that's 1 to complete this row. So we can check that all of the conditions here are met. That is how we solve a KenKen puzzle. This ends our presentation on problem solving and reasoning. Thank you for listening.